All right, looks like the recording has started. Good morning, everybody. We are gathered here today to talk about Celery and kind of level set expectations, do a little education, maybe go through some demos. My expectations here is the audience have mixed experiences. Some of us have lots of experiences with Celery. Some of us have no experiences with Celery. So my intent here is to give us that brief introduction, tell you what it is, give us some examples of how we can use it. So that our project can start using it soon. There's going to be kind of three parts to this. One is the slides that we have here, where I'll kind of talk through some examples, but then I'm going to open up a command line, show you some actual examples, and then if we have time at the very end, I'll switch branches to my quipucords Celery branch that I didn't put a PR up over the weekend, so you can see a real live example of how we might actually use it. So here we are. Yeah. What is Celery? Celery 101. That's the title of today's meeting. I didn't put together a lot of notes. Hopefully it's enough to kind of follow along while I'm talking. Yeah. Brief introduction. How might we use it? What is Celery? Textbook definition. This is literally copied and stolen off of the official Celery docs, but I'll read it because it's a good summary. Celery is a simple, flexible, and reliable distributed system to process vast amounts of messages while providing operations with the tools required to maintain such a system. It is a task queue with a focus on real-time processing while also supporting task scheduling. That's basically in a nutshell. It's a suite of commands and tools to process messages. What does that actually mean? Hopefully the examples I walk through will explain that. Before we get into the examples, though, you might ask, okay, we have native Python things for similar tasks, right? We've got threading, multiprocessing, async IO, all of which are great. They work well when the situation applies, right? So this is very much, I believe, a choose the right tool for the right problem, for the right job. Celery, and let's see here, do I have more on this? Yeah, okay. So the reasons I think Celery would be applicable for us and for some projects, not all cases, are kind of these keywords that I kind of pulled out of the air. Isolation is a big one. So with tasks running in a Celery worker, they are wholly isolated from your web service. So in our case, we're running a web service. We run additional things or partially a web service. We want to run additional things alongside it. Isolation, in this case, you can run your workers on a completely different machine, maybe in a completely different VLAN, different part of the network. It's isolated from your web workers or other things that are creating the tasks. Scalability is a big factor here. Celery workers, you can have as many or as few as you want. The individual worker can have multiple threads and processes, and you can have multiple workers themselves, and you can have dedicated workers for different categories or individual tasks. So scalability, big point here. Robustness, it's a mature framework. It's been around for a long time. I don't know, 10 plus years, I think. I don't have the exact dates with me, but it feels like it's been about 10 years. It's very robust, been used by a lot of teams, companies, organizations, you name it. So it's battle hardened in that sense. And convenience, like as someone who's used Celery for several years, I have 5+ years of experience on multiple projects with Celery. I'm comfortable with it. So that's kind of part of the convenience, right? But it has various utility functions, which we'll talk about soon, that I don't know. I just find them easy to use and convenient. So that's much more of a kind of subjective opinion there, right? Alternatives. Celery is not the only player on the block here. Dramatic, RQ, and Huey are all available, popular in their own rights. Why wouldn't we not choose to use them instead of Celery? I kind of have a two-part answer. One part is I just have more experience in Celery personally, so it's my go-to. That being said, if someone else had more experience with Dramatic, I'm sure that would be their go-to with that service. But secondly, I know that Celery also has a really good integration with Django, which is what our project is built with. So hang on, I saw a ping. Let me jump over to the chat. Bruno, what you got?
Oh, I hope this doesn't ruin the recording, but... regarding scalability, I have a question. Hold on. Oh, we can push it out. Hey, what's the difference of scaling with multi-processing or scalability with Celery? I could bring multiple processors. If I really care about scalability, why would I use that, huh? Oh my gosh, I'm kind of seeing some impression was awful. Oh,
I didn't know you brought your friends with you in today's meeting. No, that's a fair question. So in this sense of scalability, it's it's responding to the need for scale is kind of better, how I better kind of describe this. With when you're programming, depending on how you're programming, based on what I've seen around us, if you're writing something in our service to use processes and threads, it seems to have been, all right, I need to proactively decide how much I need before I actually use it, right? Whereas this kind of scalability I'm talking about is more kind of on-demand reactive, if we wanted such a thing, right? So if we have multiple requests coming in from different places or multiple requests from the same place, from the same user doing something, right? We could have the system observe the depth of the queues, for example, or the load on the systems, spin up more workers as needed, spin them down as needed. I'm kind of thinking of like auto-scaling in terms of like Kubernetes, OpenShift, things like that. That's when I'm thinking of when I'm thinking scaling, that's the kind of thing that I'm thinking of. Is that in line with what you're kind of getting at, Bruno, or did you have other thoughts or questions to add to that?
I just would add also make the distinction between the ability of scaling vertically versus horizontally.
Yes, that's a good point. Yes.
Because native, I think there is a way to horizontally scale multi-processing, but I don't think anyone uses it.
Right. Yes, no, that's a very good distinction here. We're talking scaling in both directions. If we use something like Celery, and I say something like Celery, like Dramatic, HUE, all possibly could work in the same way. I'm speaking of Celery specifically. That yes, vertically you can add more hardware, or horizontally you can spin up more instances of them, so you can go in any direction for that. So Greg, you had your hand up.
Yeah, actually that was the point I was going to make about scaling horizontally.
Yeah,
I guess you could, but you'd probably have to write your own management there, you know, so somebody did that already.
Exactly, yeah. And I don't know if someone else put their hand up and put it back down.
Well, I put my hand down.
Okay, that might be what I saw. Okay, cool.
Basically,
good questions, by the way. I didn't mean to say this earlier. Do interrupt me if you have, if I've made a mistake. I will probably make mistakes, or if you have questions, or if you want further explanation on something, if I'm gone too fast, speeding through things. I will qualify that last point, though, to say that I will continue expanding as I explain. So if I haven't gotten to it yet, maybe hold your thought. I don't know. Use your judgment. Yeah, going back to the prepared slides, whatever. We're not using these mostly because we don't have experience with these. If we had years of experience with RQ, we'd probably use that. But we don't. So this specific project doesn't. Other projects, they might make much more sense. Excuse me. I'm going to go ahead and jump into some very basic textbook examples that hopefully outline or explain this thing here about like, what do I mean by the system that processes message and so forth, right? So what do we have? What is a task? I've said several times before, and the docs say itself, that Celery executes tasks, it manages tasks. A task for Celery is effectively a function, and it's just a Python function. There's generally nothing special or magical or special about them. I guess I already said that right. They are just functions that are decorated with this app task, or other decorators I won't get into right now. This is the most basic use case I'm looking at here, with a couple of qualifiers, right? So add, summarize, or some, like numerically sum, ping. These are, again, I think literal textbook. I think I might have stolen these from the docs. If not, I rewrote them from memory in this example here. And I'll walk through an actual demonstration of this in just a second here. So but what makes them different? One, they've got that decoration on top, task. Shared task and Django, there are distinctions that I won't get into right now, but they're more or less the same. But also, these functions must have serializable inputs and outputs. And so those are your function arguments, and that's your return value, right? And by serializable, I think by default, it is JSON serializable, although you can give it a different serializer. You can even give it the Python pickler if you really want to go out there. That's not suggested, but it can be done. We've done it in other projects. But those are really all you need to remember. So a task is just a Python function that's been decorated and has serializable inputs and outputs. I guess one other thing I should mention about serializable inputs and outputs, in the case of us being a Django project, but this also applies to other projects as well, this means that you don't want to give the function or expect out of the function a heavyweight object. And by that, like a Django model object that might have a database connection associated with it or something that has file handlers open. You don't want that because that connection and those file handlers aren't going to exist when the task runs on another machine. So in the case of something that might deal with a particular Django model, you might pass the id into the function and allow the function to go look up the object. Because again, it's just a function. It can talk to the database. It can import your other code. But the inputs and outputs are what you want to control carefully as you write those functions. Here's just another kind of silly arbitrary example. Maybe better highlighting why I would want to use Celery in this case. So in the previous one, adding two numbers, this is mostly just to demonstrate that it's a function, right? Why would you write a task for that? You probably wouldn't. But something like this, a so complex operation where it's going to take a minute or so to calculate something before returning a number, you might not want that holding up a thread on your machine. Or imagine this. Imagine it takes not seconds or minutes, but maybe hours or a whole day. Hopefully not a day, good God. But maybe it takes much longer than that. You probably want the ability to stop and restart your web service while this thing goes and runs in the background. If you're using a Python native, like a thread or a process that's kind of forked off of it, depending on how you're forking it, that might not be possible. But since Celery is divorced from your application in terms of the actual execution, it continues to run in the background. You can restart, redeploy, do whatever with your web service while it's running. All right. So how do you send a task? Or how do you execute a task, I should say? So send is the kind of keyword that I will be using in my conversation here, because that's the word that Celery and the Celery docs use to describe the request to run a task or to request to run a function, right? So in my client web server code, right, I might call the add function, but let's say I want to run it over in Celery. Instead of calling add directly, excuse me, what I'm doing is I'm sending the add task, the send add function to a Celery worker by calling apply async or delay. Apply async is your most verbose way of calling a task, right, or sending a task. You can send it the non-keyword arguments, the keyword arguments, and additional options that are Celery specific, things like delays and other things about telling Celery special things about the task itself, things you might want to run after the task, other requirements, things like that. Most commonly, I expect most of us will just use the delay method, which is simply a shorthand for apply async, ignoring the options and unfurling the args and keyword args into just regular arguments. So delay 1, 2, as opposed to delay args tuple 1, 2, et cetera, right? Still probably not making a lot of sense. We'll get more examples here, right? Oh yeah, but I guess before I get into the other examples, when I say this is sending a request to execute this function, what do I get back out of it? What I get back out of it is this unusual looking thing called an async result. I'm not getting the number 3 out of this because I'm not actually executing the code on my local process, right? I'm asking someone else to go execute this for me. And so what I get back is this object that I can then interrogate for the response that would come out on the worker. I can ask the async result, are you ready? Have you actually been processed yet? I can ask it to describe itself. Like what was the parent graph of this thing? If it has multiple tasks related to each other. And then ultimately, yes, I can ask it for the real result. I think get is the method we'll get into in just a second here. And it can block and wait till you get an actual response in that case. Or you can just discard it. You don't need to do anything with this result. If it's something that's like a maintenance task or something that is itself going to be writing results to a database or writing results to a file, then you can let the task just do that. You don't have to handle the results yourself. You can just assume that the task is going to deal with it itself and discard the result, walk away, and never think about it. There are certainly use cases for both. I suspect we will be doing more of this, where we just discard the result. I'm going to go back here. Getting the results. Yeah, here we go. So the next one, talking about getting the result. What can you do with that result object? Here's an example. So I am sending a request to call the delay function with the add function with 1 and 2. So I say add delay 1, 2. And from that, I get a result, this kind of async result object, right? Then I can ask that object, are you ready? Has whatever worker, wherever it lives, actually executed this and returned its result? So the ready method will return simply a true or false Boolean. If you don't have any workers, it will probably return false forever. And because it will just keep asking the broker, which is one part of the backing for Celery, are you done yet? And it'll just say, no, I'm not done until it doesn't work. And finally, get will get the results value, assuming that it's ready. If it's not ready, this is a blocking call. This will hold your thread. This will hold whatever you're executing in until it gets a result. Think of this like opening a connection to a database or opening a connection to a file, and you're reading and you're not closing it until you get your answer out of that that stream. That's what get is doing here. And the final output of all of this is the output of that original function. If I were to just call it the normal add function with 1 and 2, I would expect the integer 3 to come out. And that's exactly what I would get from result.get in this case, is simply the number 3. No like special object wrapping, just the actual value. So task composition is a whole discussion of itself, but I'm going to try to cover some of the ways that you can mix and match different types of tasks and their styles of execution. Because what we've looked at just now, this results equals add.delay, is just shooting one task into the system. It's saying, hey, I've got an add. Please execute this one add, right? But what if I have multiple things I want to run in parallel? Or what if I want to run multiple things in sequence and have them chained together in some interesting way, or like some combination of the two? You can also do mapping and star mapping and other techniques that I'm not going to talk about here, but let's get into some of them. I guess a prerequisite I have put in my notes here is when you're composing these or orchestrating these tasks, you need to have a representation of the task to pass into this thing that might group them or chain them together, right? And the representation of a task is called a signature. So if you want to pass around a description of the invocation without actually calling the task, you pass the signature on. It's kind of like a Python partial, if you're familiar with partial, but it's not exactly like a partial, right? It's basically, I've given you the object that represents what would be this call without actually calling it. And then you can organize that. So, right. So in this case, I've grabbed the signature for, if I were to call add with 1 and 2, I call dot S. Dot S I didn't even say this earlier. Let me rewind. I've said that the functions have this like apply, async, delay, and now this S thing, where did those come from? Because we go back to the actual task definition, where is it way up here? I just wrote a function, right? It's this decorator. Because functions are first class objects in Python, you can actually append methods and attributes to functions. And so that's what the task decorator is doing, is it's adding special things to that add function that are then used by Celery. So if I forward myself again here, go back to where I was. So delay is one of those things that Celery is adding into your just plain Python function. Here we go. So S, the method for signature, is again one of those things that the Celery decorator has added to the add, in this case, function. I should have picked a better name for that. I apologize. But by calling .s on it, I'm getting a signature. So now what I have is an object, I'm just calling it sig for now, for short, that represents the what would basically be sent and serialized to the back end, saying, hey, I want something to execute add with the arguments 1 and 2. That's what this signature object is, right? And so then I can pass it around. I can call it multiple times and I'll get multiple results out of it. So in this case, I called sig delay, sig delay, sig delay. And each time I got a different async result object out of it, because each time I called delay, it is putting a new request onto the message queue for some worker somewhere to process. This will be useful for grouping of tasks. This is one of the things that I alluded to a few seconds ago, right? So in this case, I'm using a Celery function called group. And you give group an iterable, a list, a tuple, whatever, of decorated tasks or signatures in this case, right? So I've said, I want to send it the add of 1 and 2, add of 3 and 4, and add of 5 and 6. So what I'll do is on the back end, and I'll show you the back end in a little bit, I promise, is that's going to send a request for add 1 and 2, and add 3 and 4, and add 5 and 6. And bundle them up in such a way that I've got this group identifier for them. Calling Celery group will also return an async result, like just calling delay does. I'm sorry, calling a delay on the group returns that object, just like on directly on the function would be. And if I hit, if I call .get, which I omitted a few lines here, right? So if I call .get on that result, assuming that execution has completed, I will get the group as a list with the individual tasks as the contents of that list. So add 1 and 2 gives me a 3, add 3 and 4 gives me a 7, and add 5 and 6 gives me 11. Hopefully pretty straightforward, even if it's new to you. Chaining is another pattern that you might apply. In this case, I want to run tasks sequentially and have one feed into the next and feed into the next and feed into the next. This is different from the previous one because with grouping, I guess one thing I should point out is these are not running sequentially. These are running parallel. They might run out of order because if I have n number of workers pulling from the message queues, they might pull the first, second, and third at the same time, slightly out of order because as they're individually delayed by doing other operations, and they might be returned in different orders. But the group effectively will wait for them all to return before I process the results. The chain is very deliberately in order. It is sequential, right? And there's two different syntaxes here. This might be hard to read at first, but hopefully I can explain as we go. So I'm going to talk about this first one here, right? Celery.chain. This is much more like Celery.group that we just talked about. So Celery.chain, you also give it an iterable or a list of tasks or task signatures in this case. And what it does is it calls the first one, and then it takes the return value of that and feeds it into the second one. And then it processes the second one and feeds the return value of that into the third one, and so forth and so on down the chain. Now, for adding, this is a contrived example. It doesn't really make sense. So in this case, what it's actually doing is it's saying, send a task for add 1 and 2, get the return value of that. Now have a task that takes the return value of that, which was 3, and add it with 4. And then take the return value of that and add 9 in the next one. And the end result, I kind of wrote a comment here to kind of explain, like unwrapping it mentally, what that's actually doing is adding 1 and 2, then feeding that into the next one to add 4, then feeding that into the next one to add 9, and you get the final result. Now, this other syntax I have here with pipes is a convenience. It's just an operator overload with Celery. I imagine, like I didn't read into why they made this alternate syntax, but I would imagine it's because there are a bunch of Linux developers like we are, and they're accustomed to using the pipe operator in the shell terminals like bash or zsh, whatever, right? Because if you think about how the pipe operator works there, you run a program and you use the pipe to redirect the output of that program into another program. And that's conceptually what this is doing. It's running a task and it's taking the output of that task and redirecting it as input to the next task, plus other things optionally, right? So either of these can be used. They're effectively equal in terms of their execution. They're just, one of them is syntactic sugar over the next one. Another thing you can do is kind of combine these concepts, right? So we've got grouping, where it runs things completely asynchronously. They do not depend on each other, versus chording, where you've got one thing that, I'm sorry, versus chaining, I misspoke, where you've got one task that leads to the next. Chording kind of combines those, right? Where it takes a group of things and then effectively has a callback, which acts like a link in the chain that we just described. And what does this actually do? So I've made myself just a list of sets of numbers. Again, contrived example, right? And I'm creating myself an iterable. This could be written out individually, like I did previously, but I'm trying to get a little bit more advanced here. So this might be more akin to what we would write in code, where we're going to iterate over things, right? So I'm taking these lists of tuples. For each of the tuples, I want to call add. So that's my group. And then at the very end, I'm going to sum them. And if we rewind, what was sum? Pretty sure I mentioned that somewhere in here. Oh, can't find it. Wherever it was, it's gone to me now. Apologize for that. But this is basically just a wrapper for the Python sum function. It takes a list of inputs, adds them together, returns the sum. Okay. So calling chord delay, again, it tells the Celery backend, I want to run these things in parallel. And then I want to treat this like a callback or like a chain link. Take the result from all of these and feed it into the sum value before getting the final result out at the end. And so again, I've kind of written some pseudocode like to describe mentally what this is doing. So it's saying, all right, take add 1 and 2, add 3 and 4, add 5 and 6 as a group of things, then sum those values. In this case, the output would be 21.
And each of those is async, right?
Yes. So in the first argument here, I think internally they call it the header. But effectively, this is the group. Because it's a group, each element of the group is run asynchronously, independent of each other, with no dependencies on each other.
Got it.
Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay, cool. And I will be showing live demos of this in a few minutes. And hopefully as we walk through them, it'll make a little more sense as we kind of repeat, right? Here is a slightly more realistic, that's not just using adding of numbers, right? This is not what we would actually do for a product, but it's a straw man example, right? So here I've written two tasks, right? One of them is called scan. You give it some sort of host identifier and some sort of product identifier, and it does scanning magic. Hand wave. We don't care about the implementation right now. We just know that it's going to do something to scan those things. And we've got another task called fingerprint, where it's going to take some list of scanned results, presumably from the earlier task, and again, the host identifier. And it does some sort of magic hand wave calculation to come up with a unique signature, fingerprint, whatever, for those scanned results for that host. And here is a potential execution of that. So I've got my host ID, 127001. I've got some list of product IDs. These are just arbitrary strings that I came up with. Here's how I might use chord to execute this by combining all the concepts we've described, right? Inside, my first argument is a group of scan calls, signatures for scan, which will eventually send them out to be executed, right? Where I am giving each one of them the host, and I'm giving them one of the product IDs, right? Then my second argument for chord is the fingerprint function, or signature for the fingerprint function. So what this effectively would do is, just like the add example, which was probably hard to follow, but in this case, it might be a little easier to follow, because what we're doing is saying, I'm going to call scan with 127001 rel, and I'm going to call scan with 127001 JBoss EAP, and with OpenShift, and with Ansible, and with Satellite, and all of these other product IDs, right? And each of those signatures, each of those calls that I am sending to Celery runs independent of each other. They run in parallel. Or if you don't have enough workers, they run in serially if you don't have enough workers. But hopefully you have enough workers and worker processes that they run in parallel all at the same time. And then you collect results from them. Well, it's chord is doing the collecting results, right? Because it's going to take the results of that group and it's going to feed them into the fingerprint function. So it's going to take, as the first argument, those results. In this case, I also sent a host. I could have thought of this more cleverly. Maybe the results from the scan includes the host. Maybe it's some sort of dictionary object or that includes more metadata, whatever. It's a contrived example. But by doing this, I'm telling Celery, who's orchestrating my processes here, my functions, to expect to call fingerprint, but only do it after it's done all of these things with scan, because it's going to need to feed the results from scan into fingerprint. And then I call delay, right? So if this was a real shell, and if this was a real program, which, surprise, I'll show you something very similar in a few minutes, in the background, we could watch Celery executing these independently. And here in the foreground, we could call .get, and what we would get from .get of this is the return value from the fingerprint function. So we don't care about the scanning other than the fact that we expect it to have been done. We're not directly seeing the outputs of the scans. We're only seeing the outputs from fingerprint. Okay. Hopefully that makes sense. If not, more demos coming soon. Speaking of which, live demo time. Oh boy, here's where things are really going to fall apart because, you know, live demos being what they are. Before we do that, I heard the ping of someone's got a comment or question. Nicole.
So you talked a little bit about composition, but looking at it in a more broader sense, how does Celery organize tests in a project? Is there a recommended way, you know, ideal way to structure the tasks to maximize efficiency?
Yes. That is a complex question to answer, to which I'll say, let's table it for now, because there's a lot of different things we go with that. But Celery, the people who've written Celery, I should say, anticipated that. And they have multiple documents on the Celery Docs website, which, where's the website? The link down here, docs.celery.dev, right? They have, let me think if I can find it real quick. Canvas is an excellent place to look. Not sure where else, but I know that I've, I know that I've seen some best practices somewhere throughout these docs. They're very thorough. So I don't mean to not answer your question, but the docs have good examples, and we'll talk through some later, hopefully as well. But definitely keep that in mind that yes, there are best practices for how do I, here's an example, right? So one thing that I'm pretty sure the docs explicitly state is that you should be careful about writing a task that inside itself calls another task, right? Because you might end up in a case where you're going to deadlock. Because if you have tasks calling tasks, you might have one depending on another that never finishes. That's something that they realize, the authors of Celery realize could be a problem, and they caution you not to do. That's not that you should never do that. Sometimes there are legitimate cases for that. But those are the types of advice that you'll find in the documentation. But in general, they're going to advise you to, let's see, where is it? To do things like, sorry for all the slide moving. They're probably going to advise you to do things like groups, chains, chords, maps, star maps. There's probably a couple of others that I can't remember off the top of my head. By doing that, you're letting Celery deal with the order of execution, which they, it's pretty much a solved problem in their case. So yes, before I go into some live command line demos, any other questions before I move on? I am going to switch around my windows real quick. I can kill that. Hopefully this will work. All right, Google, I guess I'll have to stop presenting so I can share a different window. I'm gonna share a different window. Okie doke. This should start showing up shortly. Is that text legible? I zoomed the font a few steps to hopefully, yeah, okay, I got a thumbs up. Excellent. So I'll assume this is legible for future viewers of the recording as well. If not, I have most of what I'm about to do also typed out into a text file that I was using for experimentation yesterday. So I can give you a text file afterwards if we need to, right? All right, what do I want to do here? Blank canvas. Oh man, now I'm scared. So what I want to do is, am I in the right place? I want to look at, I have pre-written a few tasks, right? So I'm going to look at some tasks that I've written for sake of demonstration. Some of these will look very familiar. Hey, look, there's add. There's add slowly, where I've injected a sleep to slow the system down so we can actually see things happening, because normally they're going to ask you execute in milliseconds or microseconds because it's going to be so fast running on local machine. I want to slow it down deliberately with some fuzz. Like I added random in there so we can watch the message broker and we can watch a cellular worker do things instead of just like flashing everything at once. T sum, this is again thing that was in there. I don't know if I ever used multiplication in my demo, but it's just another boilerplate textbook example that I think the Celery docs use. And then, hey, look, the slightly more realistic task. This is what I started to type up for the slide we just looked at for scanning and fingerprint. In this case, scanning is just also sleeping, not doing anything interesting. It's just thinking hard for a few seconds. And then I randomly, 50-50 chance of saying yes or no, this product was found. And I print a message and return found. In the case of fingerprinting, and I use that term very loosely here. Again, it sleeps for some random number of seconds. It's always going to sleep for 2 seconds, and then about two for the random after that. And then we're just constructing a string, one or zero, based on the scan results. So if I sent 4 scan results, I expect 4 ones and zeros to come out of this being printed. Again, deliberately simple, nothing clever or intelligent or interesting here, just demonstrating that the tasks are doing something, right? So let's get out of here. And let's do, I am in my virtual environment. So let me just make a MyPython shell, right? I'm going to import tasks. And I'm just going to call it a function normal, right? Because I've said before that I can just do 1 and 2 here, and it just calls the function. If I just call the function, it just calls the function, right? So I'm not calling any of these magic methods that were appended to it by the decorator. I'm just calling the plain Python function in this case. This means that the things that you write as tasks, you might send them as async tasks, or if you choose to, you can call them directly. You don't have to send them off as async tasks. In this case, I did not, because there's nothing up my sleeves and there's no magic here. I'm not running a worker in the background. Everything you see here is what's happening. When I run a worker in a few minutes, you'll know that I'm running a worker. But let's do something different. I've mentioned delay, right? So what happens if I do that? Okay, it created an async result object. I probably should have saved that to a variable. Maybe just call it R, right? So if I do R, I can see that that's the object. Wait, oh, that's a different object, right? Because I've now sent a different request. The other request is lost. It's gone now, right? Other than the fact that I can see the ID on the screen. R is...
Are they queued up somewhere?
They are. Tasks? So the one thing that is in the background I didn't say is I do have Redis. I have Redis running in the background. If I break out of here and I look at the tasks file again, I should have said this earlier. Thank you for calling me out. I've defined a local host instance of Redis, and I've configured Celery to use Redis as its backend and its broker. I wasn't planning to get into this, but you can tell Celery, basically, here's where to send and receive messages that describe function calls, right? Here's, and that's your broker. You can also send it, I'm sorry, you can also configure a backend. A backend is where it stores the end results. And these can be to two different systems. They don't have to be the same host. You can have the backend go to a database. You can have the broker be RabbitMQ or Redis or something else. They don't have to be the same. It's so, yeah, exactly. It's really nice in that sense. And you can do all different things. I'm not going to get into it right now, but know that it's possible. In my case, and probably in our case, we're just going to use Redis for both of them. So when I said dot delay, because these have been decorated with that Celery app, it knows to send them to Redis. In fact, you know what? Let me go ahead and do this. I'm going to split my screen. Whoops, what am I doing? Oh, I'm not using screen. Let me jump on screen. Okay, so let me split my screen. Actually, yeah, I'll do it like this. And from here, did I lose my virtual environment? Let me do, is that my history? Yeah, okay. No, I'm sorry. I don't want to run the worker. Clear that out. Nothing to see here. What I want to run is a Redis CLI monitor. So this is used for debugging. We're never going to actually use this. This is just for me to show you that Redis is running in the background, and Redis is receiving messages when I switch back over here to my Python shell, right? So I'm going to import tasks. Oops. Tasks. A delay. Hey, look at that. So as soon as I hit delay, there was some activity over in Redis. Monitor, if you're not familiar with the Redis CLI, is exactly what it looks like. It is a real-time monitor of what's coming in and going out of Redis. So what this tells me is when I hit delay, it ran all of these things in Redis. That's an implementation detail that we generally don't need to care about, but it's just nice to see that things are happening, right? Let me do it again, because I need to actually hold on to the result, right? R equals this, it did more things. Tell you what, I'm actually gonna close that because we don't need to see it right now. I just want to show you that that's happening. And if I did R.ready, which is the thing I talked about earlier, it says false. And I can keep doing that until end of days, and it is never going to give me true because I don't have a worker running. I mentioned earlier that if I try to do get, if the result is ready, it will return it. But if it's not, it will block. So I press enter, and it is now blocked. And it's going to sit here basically forever, or until I either cancel my request, killing the process, or I start up a worker in the background. So let's do that. I'm going to start up a worker in the background. Let me split the screen this way. Oops, give me a minute. Oh, geez. There we go. What do I want to do? I want to run my Celery worker. So a Celery worker is invoked by calling Celery. You tell it the application it's running for. In this case, tasks. I just put it all in one Python module. It's called task. Worker is the command that I'm giving the Celery program. In this case, I'm telling log at info level because we want to see some things, but we don't want to see everything, right? It's gonna be, all right, it's starting up. Oh, so something just happened. That was interesting, right? On the top terminal, you see that 3 just appeared. And on the bottom terminal, you see actually multiple tasks receives because I gave it multiple commands earlier, right? And then sure enough, one of them succeeded, and then the other one succeeded. They both returned 3 because I called it with the same arguments. But you can see from the Celery worker when it receives a task and when it has succeeded in completing that task. If I had logger statements inside of task or print statements in the task, they would show up here in the worker's logs by default. Of course, you can reconfigure logging how you like.
So like the main thread made the 2 ready, and then they were forked workers that delivered them, I guess?
Yeah, so one thing that you can't really see here is, let me see if I can do this. Yeah, okay. So if I scroll up here, at the start, yeah, you can see this concurrency thing here. So even though I'm only running one Celery worker, by default, Celery understands that you probably want multiple workers. So I think the math it does is it looks at your number of cores times 2, which, yeah, I've got a 6-core machine, so it gave us 12 workers, right? So I will show you an example in a few minutes if we have time. I guess I'm talking more slowly than I anticipated, where you'll see multiple workers output kind of interleaved with each other because they're running asynchronously each other. So let me clear that out just for a sec. Switch my tab back up here. So let me do another contrived example. I'm going to go to my notes off screen real quick and steal an example. I'm going to just jump straight into my realistic fingerprinting thing here. So what again, I'm just going to paste this in here. We had the host, which I said was 127, and a bundle of product ids. So make sure host is what it is. Product is what it is. Okay, cool. So what I want to do is effectively what we saw in the presentation, which was to chord these together. I want to call the scan. I want to send requests for scan once for each of these product IDs. And then I want to tally up all of those results with a fingerprint call. Let's do scan dot. Okay, let's just do one of these just to see what it looks like, right? And I think the arguments were host and product is, I'll just do the first one, right? Result. I can do it this way. I'm just going to do .get because I instead of handling a result object, I'm just going to call get directly on. Okay, so it's hanging for a few seconds because if you remember, I baked a sleep into that function. And on the bottom half of the screen, you can see it started. In this case, it didn't find, because it's just a random true or false here, that value. And sure enough, this thing returned false. Let's do it again, just for fun. It's scanning, ooh, doing magic. In this case, it found it, because again, it's just a random value. In this case, it returned true, because it just happened to find the value. Let's do multiples of these. Let's do, let's see, let's do 4. Oh, I want to do this. Let's do this as just a Celery chord, because I just talked about that. Whoops, I didn't mean to do that. Let's see, did I import chord? I don't think I did. Okay, so from Celery, import chord. I'm going to say chord. Chord. So I'm doing this off of memory. Of course, now that I'm on camera, I'm sweating. I'm like, oh God, how do I type? I can't type. All right, so chord takes 2 things, as we just discussed. One of them is going to be an iterable of task signatures, and then the other one is effectively the callback task signature. So I'm going to say the iterable is going to be scan.s, some new signatures here, of host product for product in product IDs. Oops. Oh yeah, I make mistakes. I can't type live. So let's break this down first, right? So sorry. So I've got an iterable, a generator, right? A for loop. So 4 product IDs for each product in the product IDs, I'm going to have signature of a scan that includes that product. Okay. So that's our first piece. Second piece is the fingerprint. So fingerprint.s. Did I take host as an argument? I think I did. We'll find out soon. And close parentheses. So now I've got a chord with 2 parts. The first argument is the iterable, or the list or generator of multiple scans in this case. And the second part is the fingerprint, which is going to expect to receive the results from all those scans. So let me grab that as results. Now, pay attention to the bottom screen, because what we should see is a whole bunch of tasks are being received, and then at different times, they're going to succeed and complete because of the randomness that I put in the delay. And the randomness is there deliberately to simulate different execution times. Okay, so a bunch of them started, and then at different times, they're gradually all finishing. I don't know if that was very obvious from the other side of the recording, but they all kind of staggered in. And then at the very end, the very last one was starting the calculation after all the others finished. It waited a second or so, and then it returned its fingerprint. So now I can do r.ready. I should have done this a few seconds ago. True. If I did it a few seconds ago, it would have said false. And if I do r.get, hey, look, there's our fingerprint, 00011110100, which would be the true falseness of the products in order. Again, a very contrived example, not realistic by much of a stretch, but hopefully that kind of describes what you could do. So maybe this isn't going to return a binary string. Maybe this is going to have fingerprint store a result in a database. Or maybe it's going to write a file to the file system, or multiple file systems, or make an API call to yet another thing. Or, as I said, maybe you should or shouldn't do, call yet another task to do yet another thing. So hang on, I got a notification somewhere. Nicole, what you have?
How does Celery handle task failures?
Yes. Oh man, I'm so glad that you asked that. That's something I wanted to talk about and completely forgot. So let me give you a contrived example, because we have add, right? Is add here? Add's not. So tasks.add. Okay, so task.add is like an excellent example for this. I give it two integers, and it gives me an integer result, because the content of add is simply adding those values. Well, what if I give it something that it can't add? What if I give it one and, potato, right? You shouldn't normally, let me control C that. So what if I did one plus potato? That's a type error. Like, I shouldn't be able to add a string and an integer. So if I recall the function that way, I'm calling the function directly here. I'm not telling Celery. I'm just calling it directly. I get the same thing, right? A type error. Now, what happens if I send this to Celery and ask it to execute it? Send. And I'm going to need to hold the result. So that's r.that. Again, watch the top and bottom, because this is going to be sent to the broker. The broker is going to read the message from the broker. It's going to try to execute it. Wait, I didn't mean send. Oh man, I'm using the word send. I mean delay. All right, so something interesting happened. In the bottom screen with the worker, we have a stack trace. In the top, we don't have anything because we haven't asked for the result yet. We haven't asked for the return value yet. If I do r.ready, what is it going to tell me? True, it's ready, because ready isn't telling me whether it got a valid result. It's just saying, has it completed execution? Which from the bottom, it looks like it completed execution, even though it raised an unhandled exception. What happens if I do r.get? This is where things get interesting. Ooh, it raised an exception. Now, if you remember half an hour ago, when I said that Celery tasks are serializing their inputs and outputs, that includes things like raising exceptions. It considers that to be an output. So it has to be able to serialize the exceptions so that when you pass it along for the caller, in this case, my .get, it's going to unserialize and raise that same exception that was raised in the backend worker. So you'll see type error, you can't add int and str, is exactly what happens if I just call it directly. Type error, can't add int and str. Let's say we have my scan and fingerprint, you can't do that way because I don't actually do anything interesting with them. You know what? I can do with fingerprint. Let me do that. I'm going to do fingerprint dot, just call it with none and none, right? Because what that's going to try to do, if we remember the implementation for fingerprint, is the first argument is the list of scan results. I was going to try to iterate them. Can you iterate none? Oh yeah, I forgot I put a sleep in there. Ah, none type is not iterable. So let's do the same thing with Celery. So I'm going to say dot delay, save the result. And on the bottom, we should see the same problem occur. There's our calculating, task receive, it's thinking and sleeping. And sure enough, it raised the exception internally. The new r.get, boom, I get the exact same exception on my local side. So I guess the short answer to all of that, to answer your question about how our error is handled, is if it's an exception, and as long as it's serializable, which it should be, if we're writing custom exceptions, we might need to teach it how to serialize them. But if you're using native standard Python exception types, exceptions with like type error, I think even Django exceptions are generally serializable. And don't quote me on that, I need to check. But most exceptions, as long as they're shareable, should come right back up to check later. As you see below, also things get logged, write a standard logger, however you like. So does that answer your question, Nicole? I switch screens. I'm not seeing you. Okay, I'm seeing thumbs up. Okay, cool.
All right, yes.
No, It's okay. So I had hoped to have time to walk through and demonstrate that PR that I showed in Slack the other day ago. But we're basically out of time. We can go over and talk about that more later if you like. But knowing that we only allocated an hour for this, does anyone else have any questions that we could talk about in the next 5 minutes? And if you don't have any questions, I'll switch over and actually show you that PR. All right, I'm seeing a nodding head, and I'm not seeing anyone else respond. So yeah, let me control C these, or control D, and tab over to here, control C, kill the worker. Actually, you know what?
I have a question.
Yes.
What do you use to configure your prompt? It's so beautiful.
Yes. So first of all, my shell, let me do this for you. Let me kill that first. Echo dollar shell. What shell am I using? ZSH, whatever. with ZSH, I'm using power level. There's a third party add-on for ZSH called power level, I think.
Okay,
it's been so long since I've configured it. It's like power level 9000. P9000 or something. So P9K. P9K or P10K, whatever. Go Google it. It's open source. It's in GitHub. You can configure it, and then you can configure it to have all kinds of things at the top, including paths. In this case, I've got my Python virtual environment. I've got my Python version. I've got a clock. If I had a long run task like sleep, if it's a long run task, it'll tell you how long that task ran when it comes back. If it's short, it won't tell you, whatever. But yeah, ZSH with P9000 installed. There, it took 10 seconds. Cool. Let me break out of here. Kill all this. Okay, so changing topics. Although I will say, I'll ask one last time. We are at the top of the hour. Checking my calendar, I don't have any obligations to go to, but if anyone else needs to drop, go right ahead, be my guest. But for those of you who want to stick around, also, welcome, stay around. I will stop this sharing, okay, cool, because I'm actually going to share everything. Get real ugly real quick, because I need to share multiple things. I'm just going to share my entire screen. What could go wrong with sharing my entire screen? Waiting for the... Okay, looks like...
We find out that you have an obsession with cat videos or something like that.
Oh, yeah, I know, right? let me hide all of this. Don't care about that. I'm just going to hide this. Oh, look at all the emotes. Love the emotes. Okay, there's two things I'm going to play with here. Oh, speaking of cats... new tab. I'm going to be bouncing my windows back and forth. I apologize in advance. Make a new shell here. I need to zoom the font again. 2, 3, 4, 5. Those are the other tabs. Don't need those. I'm going to cd into my quipucords project. I think that's the right branch. Ooh, I'm going to do this poetry shell. And then I'll do screen to have multiple views on the same screen at the same time. And what I want to do here is, let me go into my database real quick and truncate because I was truncate bench tables. Clear a bunch of data out that we don't care about right now. Great. And what do I want to do? So what I have here is I'm on a branch of quipucords, our Django web service. For those of you who are not on the team watching this from YouTube or wherever I happen to share this, just follow along. The quipucords is the project that we are working on. So I'm in here. Where am I? Yeah, okay. So this is the top of the repository. And I want to do a couple of things. I want to run Django itself. So I'm going to make serve. And I'm going to make another. Oh, wait, shoot. Cancel that. Sorry. I want to put this in a screen section so I can have multiple pans, right? So make serve. Start itself up. Sorry, control C. Let me do one more thing. So in my environment, I want to enable my scan manager that uses Celery, which is a new thing that I've added. Fantastic. Break out of that. So clear. Now I want to make serve. Live demos. Gotta love them. Okay, it's started. It's doing a thing. So if I switch over to my web browser, not this one, this one, 127001, log in with my generic admin user. Welcome to quipucords. There's nothing because I just truncated a bunch of tables. That's what I expect. Behind the magic curtain, I have this morning set up an EC2 instance. This is a temporary address. So it'll disappear when I shut it down. I'm going to use that to create a source. Network next. I'm just going to paste the name in. That's fine. I also already have a key that I've saved locally. I've baked in here as my credentials. Before I hit save, let's go back to the terminal because a few things should start happening, and I want to let you see them as they happen. And I don't have any magic sleeps like I did earlier. So let's start by, let's split the screen horizontally. And in the bottom one, I'm going to, let's run the worker, make celery worker. That's the make target. We'll find out in just a second. Okay, cool. That's the make target. All right, so it's ready to do things. If we jump over here, I hit save. And if I'm not mistaken, no, it didn't do what I wanted it to do. All right, hang on. Live demos, what did I warn you about? So let me control C this. You know what? Let me source my .env file because I think because I opened poetry as a shell, it sourced the .env and it lost those things already. So now if I run the serve, switch over here, source my .env file, run the worker again. Now I think it should actually be using Celery. Close this. Delete it and start it again. Let's pretend that didn't happen. All right, let's copy my IP address, host name with an IP in it, using the credentials I pre-baked. All right, I am going to want to tab back over the terminal so we can see these quickly. Save tab. Oh, what the? Did I not have all this set up correctly? Tell you what, let me just cancel all this out and, Kill that. We're out of screen. Make sure my end file is correct. So I have with Celery. I don't think that should make a difference. Let me take that in here too. That should make a difference. It's limited out, so that's fine. Let's see here. Rerun project shell. Wait, no, I said I want to do this on screen because I killed screen. All right, poetry, let's just do it from the outside. Poetry run, make serve. I'm not gonna bother to start the worker yet. Let's just see what this does. Oh, good, okay, good. That's what I wanted to see. So I just screwed up my virtual environments, environment variables. I apologize for that. It happens, live demos, something's gotta break. So yes, this is a warning message that I have my special Celery thing emit just to warn us that this thing kind of sort of works, but don't expect it to work completely. So now I will split my screen. Clover, new session. Poetry, run, make, celery. Hopefully it's going to do the right things as well. All right, it's getting ready to do things. I'm going to switch back to my web browser again. Delete this, and copy that value, make sure I didn't lose it. Delete you. Network range, address, EC2 user, save, tab over. Okay, I wasn't fast enough, but hopefully you're able to see some of it fly by. As a reminder, the top panel here is the web server. The bottom panel is the Celery worker. The top panel is not doing any of the task execution, which we saw earlier when I didn't have it correctly configured. I mean, maybe that's a good thing. We saw that if it was misconfigured and using the old code, the Django web worker did everything. It did all the tasks, did all the functions, right? But with Celery, it's not doing things that I want outside of it. It's just handling web things, and it's sending requests to the backend broker for the Celery worker to do. The bottom half is the Celery worker. So you saw a bunch of, can I do this? No, not that one. Oh, here we go. These are a little weird in screen to get scrolling to work, right? So if I scroll up, I can see all of the output from that command that we just run, right? So it called Ansible Playbook, and it has all the playbook output because that's what we do, right? So let me get out of there. I don't care about that. So give me some new lines. Let me switch back over to my web browser, and let me actually run scan on this. Hit scan. I'm going to just call this scan one. And sure, check all of the things, because why not? And I'm just going to scan. I'm going to quickly as I can tab over to the terminal so you can see it happen. Scan tab. So again, the top half, the web server, is just serving web things. The bottom half, the Celery worker, is working on things that probably shouldn't be the responsibility of a web service. And it's all of these Ansible plays. They are screaming by. I don't know if the video capture is representing this as well as I am, but it's like 60 frames per second just cruising by commands and their output here. So when I mentioned that this is a prototype for what our project might want to do with Celery, like here is a very basic use case. All of these scan things can and should be parallelized, and can and should be scaled up as needed in the background. Let workers deal with them as workers are available, as CPU resources are available for more workers. Oh, look at that. It reached the very end. Hey, there's that word fingerprint. Where did I steal that from? And yeah, I got it in. Fingerprint 1 of 1 saved. And let's jump over to here, hit scans. I'm going to hit download. I got a download. Let me go to my this code, just grab that over here. Oh, it's a zip file. Let me put it on the desktop. Expand the zip file. Oops. And yeah, it has all the stuff that it would normally contain because, again, a Celery decorated task is just a Python function. So anything your Python functions are doing, the Celery worker is also doing. So fantastic. There we have that. That's really all there is to show for that. On GitHub, quipucords, just for sake of showing the whole thing, where was it? Where's my draft? Oh, duh, I'm blind. It's right there. Yeah, it's got a red X because I made a typo and there's a lending error. But that's all this schema recording is. So if you're not familiar with the schema, get ready. It's one of my favorite screen recording tools. This is kind of a tangent, but I'll show it to you anyway. Eskima is kind of like screen or TMUX in that it's effectively a terminal multiplexer. It captures the output. It captures the input and output and writes it to a file that you can then put somewhere else. So this recording that you might have seen, if I pause it, it's actually text. So this is not video. This is just text that's being recreated and shown on screen. So that's one of the reasons I love Eskima is you can then see a command that someone uses, like poetry run make serve. I can select that text because it's just text, copy it, and then go run it somewhere on my own. Whatever. It's neat. I love Eskima. Advertisement over. This video was not sponsored, I promise. So yeah, that's all there is really to share about that. I guess I could I lied. There is one thing I can show. The source code for the change in this code, right? What I've done in this branch that we just showed off is some additional configuration for Celery. That's not necessarily relevant. More configuration, not necessarily relevant. Here is the interesting piece. So in quipucords, we have these things called managers that are responsible for doing lots of interesting things with processes and threads, enhanceable playbook commands. But because they're using processes and threads that fork or reuse the process in ways that are not as scalable as we might like, the long-term goal here is to convert some of those things into Celery tasks, hopefully convert all of them into Celery tasks, so that we have offloaded all of that processing from the web server worker into a dedicated Celery worker. So this Celery scan manager replaces one of those pieces that is already a process. So now instead of a process, it is putting, hey, look, there's delay. There's our magic word. Let me zoom in on this. There we go. Delay, that should be very familiar from what we just talked about. So I've written myself a task called run scan job runner that I'm delaying. So I'm sending this task function into Celery's backend. I scroll down and find where that thing exists. Here it is. Let me zoom back out. That's a little too close. Here is that task. Not much to it, right? I've decorated it with shared task, which I mentioned this briefly earlier, that when you're running it in Django, the syntax for defining the decorator is a little bit different. The reason for that is kind of nuanced. It's because it has to do with the load order of when apps are loaded in Django, when the code is actually ready to run. So you define this thing called a shared task. Read the documentation. I'm not going to try to explain it because I'll probably make a mistake. I'll screw it up. But just know that in Django, you're going to see shared tasks much more than the plain task that we saw earlier. So yeah, this thing takes an integer. Because if you remember earlier, I said that you don't want to give it big fat objects to have things like database handles. Within quipucords at large, normally when this manager is called, it's given a fat model object, right? Well, sorry, when put is called, it's giving a fat model object. I don't want to send that across the wire because I can't serialize the database connection. I need to be able to serialize this thing. So instead, what I send is just the id for it. And what do I have my task do? First thing it does, it goes to the database and gets the object, right? Then it does things with the object. This is the actual business logic. This is the interesting stuff where it's actually eventually calling the Ansible plays that we saw earlier. And at the very end, it's not really doing nothing. It's just logging the message if there's an error. Otherwise, it's calling other logic that was already written elsewhere in the app. But yeah, that's it. That's all there is to this. I'm basically encapsulating. I'm writing like an envelope. I'm writing a wrapper for other code, telling the Celery worker, go run this code. And it does it. Fantastic. Yeah, now I think I really am out of things to talk about on this particular prototype, because you've seen the code. You've seen it running. You've seen the output that, yes, it is actually splitting off and running things in a worker. I mean, I guess I could look at the database, but we don't need to do that. Everyone's seen the database. Who cares? Going back over the screen share. Any other comments, any other questions or things? Oh, I guess I missed. Then we turn off screen share, I guess. Turn off presenting. Yeah. So that way you're not seeing the hall of mirrors in my screen. I know this was a very fast, maybe very intense crash course. I hope that you were able to keep up with it. That's Celery 101 for you. Any other questions? All right, cool. When the recording is done, I will be sharing it out here and with a few other people. And I assume there'll be a transcript. If you want the transcript, let me know. I can get a copy for you. Also, if you want to get a copy of my notes and or the presentation is just a bunch of markdown text. I can share that with you as well. Otherwise, I guess we're done. Thank you for sticking with me.
Brad, we have fun with the Celery. This was freaking awesome. I mean, I know that I don't get to touch code a lot, but I love watching it and seeing it. So I really appreciate it. And also the bounty is real. on Bruno's comment about from Slack.
Hang on, I missed it. I missed the bounty. What, hang on, this is Slack. Oh, I didn't see this. Someone read this to me. I have Slack.
There's a bounty on Bruno talking about how he hates what was it? Scalability.
Hey, I didn't mention anything about hate.
Yeah. Some friend wandered into your house and
oh yeah, that's right. I forgot we had a special guest earlier. They didn't get to introduce themselves.
It was an old lady, I guess.
I was just curious.
Anyway, no, this is awesome. I love this. Thank you.
Oh no, my pleasure. My pleasure. And I guess I said this at the top of the hour. Or are in change now. But yeah, several years of professional experience I have now with Celery. That does not make me an expert. I use it and I think that I use it well. But I always have more to learn. There are more tips and tricks. Like I mentioned map and star map earlier because those are other like orchestration techniques that Celery offers. I mentioned them specifically because I've seen that inside deep within quipucords, we have multi-processing pool where we are telling the pool, I think star map. The star map function in Celery is, I believe, again, don't quote me because I'm not an expert, I believe functionally identical to multi-processing's star map. So there are some places that it's almost going to just be a search and replace. The reality is going to be much more complicated than that. But in concepts, the concepts apply with Celery. Anyway, that's my way of saying that I'm not an expert. There are things that I don't know. I've not actually used map and star map before. I've mostly just used chords and chains and groups or just calling tasks directly. So I have things to learn. We all have things to learn. But I hope it will be a fun adventure for all of us. And yes, I'm happy to share whatever little knowledge I have.
All right. Thanks for the awesome.
Thanks, everybody. See y'all in Slack later. Bye.
Using
I guess I should stop the recording. All right.